BC TV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
NAP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art issues with three guests and the host, James Carroll. Home viewers are invited to call and offer comments or questions during the live telecast. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit art service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
The BC TV studios in Reading, Pennsylvania. My name is Ron Schira. I'm your host for tonight. And with me tonight, I have my special guest. This is Barry Steely. Now, Barry is an artist, a painter. He's very skilled with Prismacolor pencils and such, and he's also what would you call yourself?
Figurative artist.
A figurative artist, right. Okay.
Although I learned this year from Simon Dinnerstein, we were taking an art course, he said anything that isn't abstract is figurative. But all these years I have been saying that I was a figurative artist because I've worked with the figures, so... There you go. Mm-hmm. I think most people agree with that.
Most people. Yeah. I was of the impression that everything is abstract, because when you are when you're putting a drawing down on a piece of paper, it's just ink, watercolor, pencil, paintings, or oils, acrylics, polymers, whatever, and it forms itself in your mind. Because you have all these marks and gestures and such on a canvas, and then when you look at it, or a piece of paper or whatever, when you look at it, all of those little manipulations of surface they cause you to put this thing in your mind together.
True, but he was going back further. I think through the history of painting, I don't think he considered anything other than figurative until we actually got into abstraction in the 20th century. Mm-hmm. And I was just reading a really interesting biography of Cézanne, and people were saying, only I'm mentioning this because you're saying one mark or two marks. They said with Cézanne, a lot of people agreed, as soon as he put down a mark or two marks, it was already... not to be schmaltz about it, but almost like a work of art, that mm-hmm. that its essence was already there with just a mark or mm-hmm. two marks.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're talking about Cézanne, you know. Of course.
Yeah.
But anyway, I have a question for the audience. Okay.
Okay.
All right. And the question for the audience is, how many of you out there have a penis? Oh, well, all right. I'm sorry. It's funny, but this is kind of like where some of the show is going to be heading, because we're going to be showing the male nude, and some of the images can be a little saucy. What can I say? Is that the right word?
If that's the word you want to use, that's okay. And we also agreed that not every male does have a penis. You can still be a male without a penis. So let's get that out right
let's
away,
get
too.
That straightened out.
Okay. So don't send any emails.
Yeah. Yell at me later for this. A lot of this has to also do with gay culture, and understanding of gay culture and male attractiveness to other males, and how that works.
Right. I make the differentiation between, I'm an artist first, I'm gay. It's like maybe I'll be coming out to some family members right here, right now. And sometimes I promote my work as gay art, but I think I'm an artist first.
You're an artist first.
But then there's different avenues where certainly you can send your work, and I have been supported in different avenues. I was proud to call myself a pornographer when I moved to New York. And you were asking before, I do live in Reading. Well, not in Reading, up in Denver. I'm a Reading artist, I'm a Pennsylvania artist, I'm a Brooklyn artist, I'm a New Yorker, I'm just whatever. I usually do my paintings at, can I mention where I do my paintings?
Of course you may.
At Goggle Works, please, please come to Goggle Works. Mm-hmm. And I do most of my drawings at home in the apartment. What was I gonna say? Pornography. So I was working for these little magazines. They had an open call for pen and ink drawings, and so they would send stories. But at that time, just an open call, send some drawings in. And I did, and three or four of them were published together. And then for over 2 years, maybe almost 3 years, they would send stories, and often you did two illustrations at a time. They paid $50, in case you're wondering which magazines. They're still available. First Hand, Guys, and Mandate, and you can probably still see some of my illustrations in the magazines, although I'm not getting paid for them anymore. So.
Oh yeah, you've already made your submission. Now they're
right.
Now they have it. So it's in their property. Well, that's pretty much how it is with every publication.
Right.
They own the image once they show it.
Yeah.
So it becomes part of their copyrighted.
Because the first time I saw it in a magazine years later, I'm going, wait a minute, I did that. I'm not getting any money for it, but. I've always said that I've really been supported along the way. From college, my parents didn't especially like my artwork, and I still don't think we actually have anything hanging at home. But they did pay for my college education. I wanted to go, I don't know if we want to talk about this. I wanted to go to PCA, but
that's where I went. Yeah.
They said no, unless I paid for my own college. And then I went to Kutztown. Kutztown was great. I loved my professors. It changed my life. And along the way, I've always been really, really supported. Years ago, a friend started a gallery called Figure Works in Williamsburg. Mm-hmm. And I was a member of that for about 9 years, and then I left because I didn't feel like he was really serving my work. I think partly it was because I had a one-person show and then a group show, and I didn't sell anything in the group show, and I actually got a bad review, too. So, I'm not supposed to talk about that. But
any attention is better than none.
And then Ralph Parks from Boston was looking for gay-themed work, and I don't even have the address of where the gallery was in the village. And it was a wonderful place. Well, first he was in Boston, then we would send work to Boston, and then he came to New York. And we had an opening, and there were nude people gilded serving food, and it was just a really neat event. Mm-hmm. He left, and a couple years later, I have to mention Pet Sylvia because he was the best. I had entered a couple shows. He was on 45th Street on either 9th or 10th Avenue, and I was with him for a couple years. He actually would take work to California. I was in like the Tom of Finland weekend there, and he would sell some of the pieces for me, and his wife did something called Tiny Fine Arts, and we did small fine arts for her, not necessarily always erotic, and she actually wound up getting us two windows at Bergdorf Goodman's one winter season, so that was neat. But then they lost their lease, and it was wonderful having a person who was supporting the kind of art that I was doing because he liked it. Mm-hmm. And was selling it for me too.
Mm-hmm. I love your work. I think it's great.
Yeah.
I like your style, your technique. I like how we'll be showing it here. But I like how you break the image down into these segmentations, but they all seem to like flow almost seamlessly. We'll give an example of
okay.
it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And, anyway, a lot of the art here is basically about the male gaze, maybe, about?
Not always. I was thinking about that because I knew we would be talking about it tonight. Not necessarily. It's I'm thinking of David Hockney because there's a wonderful exhibition of him at the Metropolitan Museum right now.
Mm-hmm.
He started out with paintings that were kind of in your face when he was still in college. He even had a painting, instead of having the male body parts, I think they're toothpaste tubes. And at that time, it was still illegal. You could have mm-hmm. gone to prison if you were caught doing any kind of gay acts. And so through the years, I mean, most of us who know our art history have seen paintings by him.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them were very gay in the beginning, but then later on, they were kind of universal. I mean, he was doing male figures too. They appealed to all kinds of people. I don't think they necessarily had to be gay. I think people who were gay looked at them and said, yay, somebody's doing the mm-hmm. kind of work that I might be doing mm-hmm. or that I want to see. But I think with David Hockney, he's just mm-hmm. surpassed everything. I think he's wonderful.
Yeah, he's great. He really is. And he's already gone through all of that other artists are approaching now.
Right.
I mean, because the culture has changed so dramatically. I mean, Hockney has to be patted on the back for his mm-hmm. his bravery at that time.
Right. Right.
So some of the work was very salacious in some terms, but most of the stuff was just guys taking showers, you know, swimming in a pool, and it had the same sort of impact as say appreciation of a beautiful woman by a poolside.
Right.
It doesn't seem like there's any problem with that when people see attractive women, you know, but when they see attractive men, that's...
Well, there shouldn't be, and the paintings are really beautiful, and they're beautifully done. Some of the earlier paintings, yes, he was brave, but more that it was kind of like, okay, so he was brave, but this is who I am. And I think he wanted to push it in people's faces, too. Mm-hmm. It was like that kind of thing. And I don't think any of us want to be told what kind of art we can do, you know, what we're allowed to do.
Right.
So I admire him for that. And, he he's painted all different kinds of things. So I think in that case... Is he a gay artist? I don't know. I think of David Hockney as a really fine artist.
Well, it's only one of the things that one of the things that defines his personality and defines his artwork is his own personal appreciation and connection, you know, with the reality that he lives. And
right.
I mean, if you're a guy, you see the world through a man's eyes. And the same thing with a woman. If a woman sees it through sees the world, she sees it through her gender's eyes.
Right.
And that's and I have a what my problem is that I always thought that love was love, okay, and that if you love somebody, you're going to be you're going to be appreciative of them.
Right.
So, I think this whole thing about gay, not gay, straight, you know, transgender, all that. It's just...
Well, we were talking about it before. It's things are very fluid now. And I was saying, too, it's like whatever scale you have, 1 to 10, 1 to 100, none of us are totally number 1. None of us are totally 100. We're all somewhere in between. And I think people have to respect that and understand that they're in that spectrum somewhere between two,
mm-hmm.
you know, so.
So why don't we take a look at a couple works
Okay, and before we do, I do want to, since we were still talking about that, and because Kehinde Wiley was in the news since, as most of us know by now, he's painted the president's portrait, there is a big exhibition of his work at Brooklyn. When I'm in Brooklyn, I live like a 7-minute walk from the Brooklyn Museum, so that's a treat too, but I did get to see his show. And I've used this artist statement in my own statement, but I've changed it a little bit. I know, again, I hate doing artist statements. Sometimes I'm just a brat about them and say really stupid things. But I thought that this was from the wall text that he has explaining some of the stuff that he did. And he wasn't addressing his gayness in this, but I think that's something that we could talk about too. It was interesting that when he was selected to do the president's portrait, And I wasn't even aware of it when that happened. I only was aware of the two portraits that have since been shown in Washington, mm-hmm. that it a big deal was made out of him being a gay artist, selected to do this portrait. But it's interesting that now that the portrait is finished, they've made no mention of him being a gay artist. The other night, I actually Googled him again, and I said, is he gay? Because I knew that he was, but I wanted to make sure before we even talked about it. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot of discussion about that, too. Yes, it's important as the first black American artist to do a presidential portrait, but he's also the first black gay artist, and I think that should be recognized. Anyway, on his wall text, mm-hmm. he has... Painting is about the world we live in. Black people live in the world. My choice is to include them. This is my way of saying yes to us. I think this was because people were asking, why do you paint black people? Why do you paint black people? In the same way that some people might ask me, well, why do you paint so many penises, or why do you do the kind of paintings that you do? So I just thought, I think this helps explain what I do, but I'm stealing it from him. Painting is about the world we live in. Gay people live in the world. My choice is to include them. This is my way of saying yes to us. So I just wanted to read that. So anyway.
That's a good statement. As far as statements go.
Even more, it's like he was talking about double consciousness. It's like it's kind of on the scale of sliding back and forth. What does he call it? He said he's not bisexual, so if this is too much about him, we don't have to. He says he occasionally drifted. He had sex with women, but was emotionally attached to men. So he's not number one. He's over here someplace. He's not 100. Mm-hmm. He's someplace in that line between. And he talks about double consciousness, which I think when you're a minority growing up, you're always aware of that because you're all of us go out on the street and we worry, often most of us worry, what are they thinking about? How are we coming off? What are we saying? But with minorities, with gay people, with black people, when you go on the street, and maybe it's not as bad as it was when I was growing up, but it certainly still is, I think, for the black population, for African Americans, it's like you're judged. I remember when I was older walking across the street in Reading, I was 30. I used to be tormented when I was a kid. This is all tying into why I want to get my work out there, too. Mm-hmm. But, you know, okay, so we're not going to talk about all that emotional crap when I was a kid, but I was in my 30s. I was crossing the street on Elm Street, and there was a car load of people, and they started taunting me and calling me names, and I'm going, I'm just walking down the street.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I've seen that under different circumstances.
Yeah.
I mean, we have a really cruel contingency in our country, which just has no forgiveness, no understanding, no acceptance. And that
for anything that's different.
For anything that's different. Or for
different than the, I'm afraid, the WASPI standard.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so.
Or they have misconceptions about what it says in the Bible about you know, certain things as being evil, not evil, that stuff. So it's time to recognize the fact that, you know, the gay people are human.
Right.
You know, and black people aren't human, you know, transgenders. You know, I mean, it's all of that. It all comes down to acceptance and living in a society where everybody is equal.
Right.
You know, in the terms of
God. I don't know if we'll ever get there.
I don't know. There was too much hatred in the world.
Everybody wants a little bit of power.
Yeah.
And then coming back to my work, and even David Hockney, that's why I'm not comparing myself to David Hockney, no way. If I would have done one painting in his early stages as well as he did, I could die happy. But just getting the work out there, it's two things. It's doing the work that I want to do, and it's partly in your face too. It's still a reminder. It's like, I should be allowed to do this work.
Mm-hmm.
I think most of the people who know my work don't find it threatening, and I don't necessarily do it that way, but it's nice colors, it's nice patterns,
mm-hmm.
It isn't dangerous. So I think sometimes, I don't know if I do that consciously to make it more acceptable or not, or to kind of
maybe a challenge.
To hide the message,
yeah,
or whatever.
You're challenging your viewers,
right?
Yeah, you're challenging them to look at this in a way where they're. I mean, we overreact sometimes. We see something and immediately you see red, and you get upset about something because
right.
your whole life has been trained to believe that this is not right.
Right.
But sometimes when you look at something, you have to accept that it is a challenge, and that for you to get upset over it is kind of ridiculous.
And it works the other way because also. As a gay person, when I saw David Hockney's early work, I was very, very excited. And when I see work that can be both, and that could have a gay slant, that makes me happy.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate work like that, and there's tons of good mm-hmm. work out there. There's two websites, and I don't know if we should even mention the name, but it's not strictly homoerotic, but you can go and see all kinds of male images, paintings throughout the ages. I mean,
mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
some of Thomas Eakin's early paintings, some of his studies, I don't know, you could almost call them homoerotic. I mean, there's some talk about his sexuality too. So it's not a great big surprise. This has been going on forever and ever and ever and ever, and will continue to. So anyway, let's look at some work.
Okay, all right. Let's go there. All right. So, okay, can we go to the computer screen? I do want to also say that some of the things that you're going to be seeing here might be a little bit open, but this is the caveat to people that do not like to look at naked male nudes. You should turn your TVs off now, if that's the case, because we're going to show them anyway. Okay, anyway, this is the first image. And what would you call this one?
I might be mixing up some of the titles because I did a whole series. I started doing a series of Prisma pencils. I wanted to do something faster, quicker, but then I get bogged down with my little tedious whatever it's called. This one's called Condition and Atmosphere. And don't ask me what that means because it doesn't necessarily have to mean anything, but I thought it was a good title.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Condition. Well, he's smiling.
And I can't remember the German artist. He had a show at MoMA. And I have his book. And I don't like to do untitled, so actually sometimes I go through books and I find interesting phrases I think that are interesting, and I'll assign them to paintings, and I think, oh yeah, this is kind of loosely related to this, and so this is a condition, and it's also an atmosphere.
Yeah, I mean, I love that background. I mean, it's just remarkable. And this is all Prismacolor?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's pencil.
It's just small. I don't have the sizes on this, but
mm-hmm.
yeah, they were all done on a black paper. And then I also, like his beard and some of the other areas, I'm trying to let that black come through also on his chest. And I don't think that this doesn't have to, I mean, we're still talking about, I guess, you know, like, okay, maybe people don't want to continue to hear about this either, but it's not necessarily homoerotic. It's a nude man with a hairy chest. I think he's kind of neat looking. I love the background. I like the colors. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't have to be, I don't think this particular drawing necessarily has to be a gay drawing. But it could appeal to
I don't believe that it is, but it does. But what I wanted to bring out into the open here was your skill. I mean, because we're not just talking about the subject matter here; we're also talking about how good you are as a graphic designer. What do you call it? Just a draftsman.
Thanks.
Yeah, because this is really excellent. Okay, let's go to the next one.
This was actually porn star. I think his name was Chris. I don't even know his last name. This was done several years ago when I was painting more freer and painting was more fun. This was still done in oils, but I had a show with a friend at the Muse Gallery in Philadelphia, and he was one of four porn star portraits that I did. He was one of my favorites. I mean, not favorite porn stars, because I never saw him anything, but it was one of the four of the... Well, you like the other one. He's called Eduardo. We'll see him later, but...
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. No, well, I really like... Well, this is like what I was referring to earlier, was the way that you get volume by separating into these sections of color that just kind of like, they just flow so well.
I must say that most of these are done from images. I don't work from models. I don't have enough money to work from models. And actually, I probably do better work from images. So some, obviously, again, back to porn stars, these were done from some porn magazines. I get my sources from all over the place, just from regular magazines, from ads, off the internet. And then sometimes I'm working on a large painting that unfortunately I didn't get done in time to enter in the Gogglewarts show, but that was partly computer manipulated, but I don't have a picture of that either, and then I've worked from that.
Well, we have a picture in here a little later in this group of a drawing that you did of a man, a naked man in the woods, relieving himself in the great outdoors, as you called it.
Right.
So that, yeah.
And that was the impetus for this evening, I think, to talk about a situation that happened at Gogglewarks that we can either talk about now or when we see the image, but... Mm-hmm.
Well, we can bring it up, but then we'll reference the image if we can.
Okay. Yeah. So this happened a year ago, and forgive me if I don't have all the details, but we had a nun. We every year have a nun juried show, so we can show several whatever paintings, drawings, and Laura Lynn, the gallery director, I had showed her this one painting. I really liked it. It was actually almost a tribute to David Hockney. It's kind of a collage painting, but
can we show this one?
Yeah. I didn't do a literal collage, but it, no, maybe we'll see it.
Oh, there it is, there it is.
This is what caused the mini furor. So it's a different body, a different head. The background is actually stolen from David Hockney. And then he is urinating, but the pee is going over the color bars at the bottom. The reindeer just happened to be on some Christmas wrapping paper. I like the colors. I thought that they worked really well together. And there's, an earlier David Hockney painting, this is not the same thing, where the person is actually smushed behind a piece of plexiglass and he is kind of smashed behind. I was thinking about this painting, besides of what it is literally, is about space, is about false space. It's not the real, I mean, there's a mountain in the background, but it's not a real mountain, it's a fantasy mountain, it's part of a painting. Mm-hmm. It's two-dimensional. The reindeer were from paper. The design was taken, so it's a three-dimensional figure, but of course, it's paintings and drawings, they're all two-dimensional. And then it's a false reality at the bottom with the color bars, but I wanted to mm-hmm. have him standing behind the color bars to give the illusion of space, but I wanted the P to be going in front of it to help giving that spatial dimension.
That juxtaposition, yeah.
Does that sound too stupid?
No.
Anyway, that's what it's about. So, a mother and a child came into the gallery. Well, Laurelin said yes, no problem. So she hung it outside of the cafe in the corner so nobody would be looking at it directly. And a mom and her kid came in, and Laura Lynn at the art committee meeting said, "You got me into a lot of trouble." Now, she didn't really mean that. She was kind of joking with me, but the father called up and he demanded that the painting be removed. He just thought it was too lascivious to be hanging in a show at Goggleworks in Reading, perhaps. And fortunately, the policy was that we could hang it, that Laura Lynn did hang it, and she said no way would she take it down. And mm-hmm. so he threatened to call the Reading Eagle, and we were hoping that he would, because any press is better than no press. So, but he didn't. And a week later, and so Levi Landis, who's director of Goggleworks, I think it was his niece, I'm not sure, forgive me, but it was a small girl. And they happened to be on the one side where the painting was, and he just happened to ask her what her favorite painting was, and she pointed to mine and she said, so.
Yeah, well, what's wrong with that? I mean, yeah, the kids are so accepting of this stuff nowadays. Everything that the children have been seeing in our culture, and I mean, this is not that serious. In fact, this isn't serious at all.
Right.
I mean, how many children are actually allowed to see the penises of their fathers? I mean, if you're, you know, when you get out of the shower or something like that, you have to cover yourself up right away so that your little 2-year-old daughter doesn't see it. Sometimes that creates more of a problem in the child's mind that, well, why can't I see my daddy, you know? Mm-hmm. It just doesn't make any sense it's not teaching the children the right manner of how to view sexuality.
Right.
You know, don't be shamed. Is everything shameful?
Right.
Yeah.
And again, I must say that I was, you know, both of them stood up for the work and would yeah. not have it removed. So I have to say that again. So
yeah. So right. So Levi
they won't show violence, and I can understand that. So this isn't about violence. This is about human nature.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, okay. So I didn't have to show somebody peeing in the woods, but that's what I wanted to paint, and that's what I painted.
Body function. yes. What are you going to do about this stuff?
Yeah,
you know, and big deal. The other part of it is too is that it's a challenging product. I think we were speaking about challenging before. Is that when you see something like this and you're not familiar with it, it actually is challenging you to look at your values, to look at your systems of judgment, and what you see as being important and not important, and why it is that way. I sometimes have to remind myself when I see something that I think that I've objected to immediately when I saw it, why does this bother me so mm-hmm. much, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
And often I'm just echoing what you're saying, often it is good if it does challenge you, if you haven't thought about something, and I'm not just talking about my work or gay male work, but work that you see that you haven't seen before, and it just makes you think. I mean, in the long run, I hope that I'm still making good art, that the painting, I happen to like the painting, and I hope other people like the painting. That's what I want.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't put stuff out there that I don't believe in first.
Right, you're not doing it out there to deliberately offend them either.
Right.
Yeah.
No. Not deliberately. But if some people, but I have to say, if some people are taken aback, then I've done my job.
You've done your job. You just stir the pot a little, you know?
Right. Yeah. I like doing that, too. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's bad.
I think a lot of artists...
And as long as people have the attitudes that they have, not just about this, but all kinds of things, then you have to keep stirring the pot. Mm-hmm. You have to keep making people think why they believe what they believe. And can you change someone's mind? Or even if you can't change their mind, can you try to help them understand either what you're doing or, yeah.
Or help them understand more about the world in general.
Right.
I mean, because it may not be just you. I mean, because right. there's...
Oh, no, I know it's not just about me.
Yeah, of course. But I'm...
Although everything I've done up until this point has gotten me here tonight, so thank you.
All right. This is great. I love topics like this. This really brings out understanding. So let's move on to the next image here. What do you think?
This is called Happy Accordion. This one was a trouble painting. This was just two disparate figures. And it wasn't working. He had a blue coat, and I would come back to it. This is just a small... I do a lot of small things because it takes me so darn long to finish them. But I would come into the studio, and I would do more things. Then I painted roses on his coat, and it still wasn't working. I thought it was too dorky. And then I got out my, the Rembrandt Cadmium Orange, and I just started doing fine lines over the whole piece, and it seemed to pull it all together. And it, people seem to like this painting. I think it's kind of fun now. Mm-hmm. And I am going to point this out. This is like really stupid. This is kind of a nod to the pink triangle, and it's just a little gay reference between his arm at the bottom of the painting. So, not that I usually do things like that, but in this case, I thought, there it is.
That's kind of a hidden suggestion.
I don't think anybody had seen it or would think of it until now. Oh, maybe.
Oh, look. Yeah. Oh, there it is. So that does really really bring it together. I mean, really, it's you need that pink. So we'll go to the next one here.
I just threw that in. I know that this isn't very erotic. This is my mom. So I had worked on her for a while. This was from a photograph that I had taken. It was a little bit longer. There was a vase of Coca-Cola in the flowers. So everything is kind of the way it was. But that background was from our old kitchen background, and I just wanted to put some color in. I don't know. She hated the photograph, but most people think I kind of captured her ennui. I would often call up and say, "What are you doing, Mom?" And she'd say, "Oh, nothing, just thinking." And I thought...
My mom used to say that too. I'd call her, "What are you doing?" "Nothing, not that you care. You know, but she never said
that. And this has nothing to do with anything, but I'm just saying this so everybody wish me luck. I'm sending this one to, I don't even know how to pronounce it. It's the one that Amy, the other person who painted the Obama portrait, Amy Sherald, I think she had won the Boucher Godwin portrait competition in 2014, and they do it every 2 years. So I'm sending this, I don't know, should I even be talking about this? This is kind of presumptuous, pretentious, but I'm sending this one to the competition this year in May. So,
well, you haven't gotten it in yet, but
no,
but Yeah, but why not? You know,
this is no harm in promoting from here.
Yeah.
No. Oh. I would be lucky, even if I get into the second tier of judging. It's really prestigious. And even with Amy, she said, you know, how it has changed her life. She was still, up until recently, waitressing. Now her paintings go for $50,000. All of her paintings from the newest show are sold, and they're talking about a retrospective. So a show like that can actually really help a person besides getting the commission to do the portrait for the president's wife. So
money's always good.
Yeah.
Yeah. So okay. Now
what is that? I forget.
Yeah. Well, it's, yeah.
A fundamental experience. A fundamental experience. That's what it is for most gay people. They're dancing. They're kissing. It's like...
Well, it's just like anybody else.
I mean,
it's just like any. It's just like any man and woman. If you're on a dance floor and you see a man and a woman kissing, it's okay. You know.
And but, so that's what I wanted to say.
Yeah. And there's a different variable of that?
These were taken from old photographs, and there was a lot of sailor photographs too, and you can find these. There's tons of them. There's hundreds of them. Most of them were black and white. I don't know. His smile is so dangerous. No, that's not the one.
Yeah, that's a different one.
Anyone. Anyway, that might be
next. Well, there's...
Well, that's just bathroom nude. Actually, I had done a whole series of small paintings, and that was manipulated. That was a manipulated photo that I had found on the web, too, and then it produced these weird kind of eerie... spotlight kind of things, so...
The shadow on his back.
Yeah, the shadow and everything.
Yeah.
Fortunately, I did sell that one, so...
I like all the intricacies in it, you know, in the back with all of the variations of ochre and purple and red and blue. It seems that it's all using color, you know, to its utmost extent, really, and make it look...
Well, I don't know about you, but sometimes I think I discovered that I think I sometimes use color as different hues or different tones. So I try to keep the tone the shading, the shadows true, but I might use a different color. I might use green, but I'll still try to keep it. Oh, we don't have to talk about this, but...
Keep the same value.
Yeah, keeping the same value, but using a different color, and... Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
That one's called Before I Put On My Makeup. I was looking especially horrible one morning when I got up. That's actually in our bathroom. And so... Oh, we were also... there was a group of us... Not that I'm so, hopefully don't sound too egocentric, but we were actually working on self-portraits for a whole year with the hopes that we would have a show at the end, which we never did. So mm-hmm. we were to do a portrait a day, although this took a couple months. So I've never had formal painting courses, because I was an advertising major in Kutztown, and when it came time for the painting course, it was full, and then I took printmaking. But I've read about the old masters doing these underglazes with the green and stuff. So I thought, okay, I'm going to do an underglaze of green, and then I was going to do realistic colors on top. But I kind of liked it green, and it actually goes back to Wiley's thing about double consciousness. Mm-hmm. I call it Before I Put On My Makeup because... unless you wake up and you're really a self-confident person and you're ready to meet the world, it's about
how we are before we leave our houses, before we leave our apartments. Mm-hmm. It's kind of being green and not knowing what color we're going to be that day or how the day is going to be or how we're going to be perceived.
Yeah, or, you know, before you put your mask on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Before the mask comes on. So, mm-hmm. Oh, there's another quote I have. This we are so accustomed to disguise ourselves to others that in the end we become disguised to ourselves. And we don't want that to happen. So,
yeah.
I don't know.
Okay. Well, let's keep moving here because this hour's just being eaten up. I mean, he just gave me a sign that said 10 minutes.
Oh, okay. I was worried. We wouldn't have anything to talk about.
No, we've got plenty to talk about. In fact, I don't think we're going to hit the end. I don't think we're going to make it all the way.
This one's called Big Eye. This is kind of like done when I did Happy Accordion. He has a big eye. I want more and more. I'm working on a series called Bad Drawings now, and they are bad, but they're bad in the way that I want them to be bad. They're bad in the way that I don't want to get caught up in the details, but I do anyway. In this one, his eye is kind of out of proportion, and I kind of liked the way it looked, and I kept it. And mm-hmm. it was, again, two images from two different things. It was from a t-shirt ad, it mm-hmm. was from a swimming trunk ad, and I just put them together, and I think, I don't know, I was kind of happy with that, too. I think they kind of work.
Well, I think it does work, because it really gets the mass and the I keep talking about volumes here with this, about how you create this sense of roundness. You know, with these different layers of blockaded color here, and you can see that the face is a little askew, but it works.
Good.
Yeah. So one more.
This is one of the bad drawings, which I kind of like. This mm-hmm. is I had. My friend has given me, my significant other had given me colored pens. Another friend has given me some colored pens and stuff. So I started out, again, from an image that I got off the web, and I just started really loose colored pen drawings. And he's very out of proportion, both of them. And then I just went back in with my Prisma pencils, which I love, mm-hmm. and I started the tedious routine of going back in. I mean, it doesn't look like a lot is happening with those colors, maybe, but that, oh, not to whine and complain, but that the colors in the car took hours and hours to get the right depth, and you just keep going over it. And thank God for my Panasonic pencil sharpener, because I really need, well, if you work like that, you really need a really, really, really sharp point. So
you go through the pencils.
So that's what I'm trying mm-hmm. to work on now. I want to have fun in the studio. I want to go to the studio and have a good time. And is that too much to ask?
No. And your choice of topic is your choice of topic.
Right.
It doesn't matter what people.
Yeah.
You know.
So I even know what this one is called. Let's see. Oh my word! I should have written down. It's because I think this is a complicated narrative. I think that's what this one is called. It's not that complicated. It's a bodybuilder with either a trainer or whatever. I just thought they looked goofy. Mm-hmm. And so there they are. Yep. And again, I do try to do what you were talking about. I like when there's a little bit of shadow going on, again, with the two-dimension. I try to get that in the figures, but mm-hmm. I love when there's a little bit of it behind. It almost goes back to the Fuhrer painting about depth and dimension. It just, even though perhaps, you know, keep calling them bad drawings, perhaps they're further away from reality. Mm-hmm. It kind of still helps ground it in reality. It gives it a shape and a form and a space where they kind of live.
Well, I like the whole sort of woodcut atmosphere to it. I mean, if you take a look at the hair running down his chest and belly there, it has almost a sort of a floral look about it. And in the portrait part of it too, it's like all broken down into patterns. And that, in a way, is also kind of cool. But, okay. So, and let's see. Okay, so now we're going to move on to this drawing here.
Yeah, and there's another drawing. I don't know if you have it or will have it. I had done, again, back to Gaga Works, which I really feel lucky to be part of, except I'm still trying to get used to having a window so people can... You know, at an open door. Yes, people, please visit me and you can come in, but it's still getting used to people being able to come in when I work. My old studio, we closed the door and that was it.
Covered
and so
the wind,
that was kind of nice too. But we're also artists of the month like once or twice a year. And so this is part of a series that I did called Fake Narratives. I don't want to say in honor of the president, but probably because of the president, because we were having all this fake news. So I don't know if you got to see them or not. I had lined them up on the wall. There was many, many panels like this. And so, again, I chose very different images to go. And the one on the left, again, that was almost kind of like the bad drawing. I mean, he's just has a crippled hand. The poodle is absolutely ridiculous. You're not sure where her leg is. And I wanted to do them fast and quick. And so then I started, but then even on the other one, you can see that I went back into it. I started slaving with the dots and the detail. So they were presented in a really long line. And then on some of them, I even went in and did color prisma again, taken from a Japanese origami paper. And then I had the brilliant idea, because I wanted more color, I put the origami paper in between the black and white drawings, and then I tacked them up, and they had little colored pom-poms on the tacks. So, yeah. And this was the other one that you liked. That was Eduardo.
Yeah.
He's one of the porn stars as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is a nice one, too. I like the color in this. Okay. And
that's called Glitter and Be Gay, and there was a lot of glitter on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, there's
and that was just a really, that's a 4x6 actually. That was a really, really small painting.
And what is it, oil? Oil paint?
Yeah, I do oil and alkyds, the fast drying oils. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
And that's the one that was in the Penn State show. After I brought it home, there was a show at Williamsburg, and I entered it. It was a nature show, and I was lucky enough for them to ask me to purchase it for their permanent collection, so it's now in the Williamsburg Art and Historical Center collection. So that was nice.
Okay.
That one's just called Hammock. Again, that's manipulated image that I found on the web. I just love the play of light, and that's mostly what I was concerned with, but I like the strange colors as well.
Okay.
And that's the one that's called Helping Hands. Nancy and I were really lucky this past summer. We were in a show outside of Philadelphia. She won first place. It was a pattern show, and I won second place with this painting. So,
okay, that's great. I think we've pretty much reached the end of the program here. I think we have about 2 minutes left, maybe. So before they give us the goodbye signal, I just wanted to ask you, is there anything coming up that we should know about that you're involved in coming up that, you know, like next week or tomorrow, you know?
No.
No, okay. All right.
I'll be judging students' work on Friday at Goggle Works, and thank you for asking me that, and for asking me to do that. I've, sent things in. Mm-hmm. For the Goggle Works. Oh, no, yeah, the Goggle Works juried show. I'm slavishly working on this new painting.
The Goggle Works, last year, fortunately, passed 10 years. Or was it the 2015?
I should know. I don't even know. Yeah.
Over 10 years. They usually say that organizations like this don't last any much longer than 4 years. But Goggleworks has proven itself a really real mainstay in this area.
Right. Yeah. A lot of artists are concerned about getting people in. Please support your local artists. I'm concerned about getting work done. I know that some of the artists want people to come in. They're mm-hmm. interested in meeting and selling. So there's a lot of good artists at Goggleworks mm-hmm. in Reading and in the area. So,
well, that's it.
Yeah.
So we ask that everybody please support the arts, no matter what it is. No matter what you agree with or disagree with, it doesn't matter. But I want to thank my guest tonight.
Thank you.
thank you very much.
Thanks.
For joining me tonight here on NAP Connections. And I'm your host, Ron Scherer, and with Barry Steely.
Thanks.
Have a good evening.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studio in Reading, PA. Airing live on the fourth Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. Check your local listings for repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts Program, call 610-683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5 p.m., Saturday 10 to 2 p.m. or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.